Thank you very much for the opportunity to present. It's my pleasure to be able to address a little bit of augmentation of rotator cuff repair and the opportunity that we have as surgeons to improve the outcomes of our surgeries, sometimes our most challenging surgeries with biowashers. I wanted to take one step this morning to talk a little bit about a problem that all of us encounter. And as we all know, one of the biggest sources of morbidity, lost time, and dysfunction in the shoulder is rotator cuff tears. And thanks to technology, thanks to Arthrex, and thanks to all of the evolution that has occurred over the past several years, our ability to address rotator cuff tears has significantly improved. Even if you rewind the clock just several years ago, the tools and techniques that we had to address our most complex tears have rapidly evolved. But it's always important for us as surgeons and as healthcare providers to ask ourselves the question, do we even need to get better, right? If you look at some of the papers or the literature on rotator cuff tears, you'll say, well, patients do quite well. I think it's super, super important for us to really push ourselves and recognize that our assessment of success when we're caring for a patient is really defined by the metric. And so if we're looking at PROs or patient reported outcomes, often our ASES scores or our WOSI scores or our PROMIS scores will show considerable improvement. But I think it's always been our principle to push ourselves to the next level. And so beyond the subjective improvement, what about objective improvement, which is structural healing, getting the tendon to truly heal back down to the bone, and our return of strength, not just range of motion, but strength and function. And what we know from our literature, even in 2021, is that we're very effective for small and medium tears, 80% or more, oftentimes getting those tears to heal with our modern day double row constructs. On the other hand, with large and massive tears, we're quite effective in conferring some pain relief and improving subjective patient reported outcomes. But where we still have considerable room for improvement is in that area of structural healing and return of strength and function. And of course, we want to ask ourselves why. Why do we still struggle in that population? And so I think one thing that's helpful for me before diving into biowashers and where and why is to just take a little assessment of what is our state of rotator cuff repair in 2021. And so what are the triumphs? And again, much thanks to Arthrex and all of the innovation that is responsible for so many of these triumphs, right? I think it's very clear for us that the vast majority of rotator cuff repair surgery in 2021 is arthroscopic surgery. Previously, tears that we were unable to address, subscapularis tears, large, severely retracted tears that always required open and extensile approaches, now are more often than not treated with arthroscopic approaches. In addition, the biomechanical constructs that we have for these repairs have significantly improved. Previous conventional knot tying single row anchors have now evolved into very sophisticated time zero, biomechanically strong double row constructs, often with knotless technology and rip stop sutures to protect our repair at the tendon bone interface. We now have means for biologic augmentation, again, in large credit to the company, thinking about products like ACP, bone marrow aspirate, thinking about patches that can be used as vehicles and scaffolds to deliver growth factors and cells. We also are constantly pushing the envelope on joint preserving alternatives. Before we jump to reverse shoulder arthroplasty, options for interposition arthroplasty or superior capsular reconstruction, including arthroscopic assisted tendon transfers, all of those are in our armamentarium in 2021. But it's equally important for us to think about where are our potential tribulations? Where are there opportunities where we still have not quite hit the mark? One is restoring the native tendon bone interface or enthesis. We know that even when we achieve healing, in 2021, that's a fibrovascular scar tissue. It's not the normal organized enthesis that transitions from fibrocartilage to mineralized fibrocartilage to bone and has the normal load-bearing capacity of a native tendon bone interface. We also know that we have not yet solved where really failure occurs. And failure most often doesn't actually occur from pull out of the anchor. Rather, the primary mode of failure is between the suture or the tape and the tendon interface. And that, of course, is one of our biggest challenges, particularly in compromised or attritic tissue. We also recognize that we sometimes have the dreaded so-called type 2 tear, where in fact the tendon footprint remains attached to the greater tuberosity, and we have a tear medial to our construct, which generates a challenge of compromised tissue, sometimes medial to the rotator cuff cable, making real challenging scenarios for revision surgery. And then, of course, we have the questions about muscle atrophy and how do we reverse that? And can we at least halt the natural history that, of course, can lead to long-term weakness and dysfunction? And it's, of course, super important to recognize that a poor quality tendon is not necessarily the same as an insufficient rotator cuff. And we need to have tools where we might have intact tendon tissue, but tissue that we need to improve upon to achieve maximal function. So these remain opportunities for improvement and will be some of the focus of my talk today. So why do these rotator cuff repairs fail? What are the reasons in 2021, at least the reasons that we can control as surgeons? Well, one is a non-anatomic reduction, and certainly all of us are guilty of that. I have been, where it's a large, chronically retracted tear. We don't do a good enough job mobilizing the articular and bursal side of the tear. We don't necessarily employ our anterior or posterior interval releases. And the end result is that our cuff tear is not appropriately mobilized to take tension off and anatomically reduce to the footprint. Or we're able to reduce it, but we have the wrong vector of reduction with our construct. Those will predispose your repair to fail, and there are things we can improve upon as surgeons. What about the mechanical construct? I just shared with you the triumphs, right? The tendon-bone interface, our speed bridge constructs, and now our knotless fiber tack and suture tack type of constructs that allow us to create rip stop stitches and double row repairs really, really have given us tremendous versatility at the tendon-bone interface. But where there is still an opportunity for improvement, and often where we forget, is the suture tendon interface, right? The idea that that is the most common location where these tendons tear, and we need to pay attention at that interface to prevent the failure. And as you can see, rip stop stitches are one approach, but another important approach is things such as the Arthroflex patch or bio washers, which I'd like to talk about today. Also, we know that this is a compromised area of biology, often an area of watershed vascularity at the rotator cuff insertion. Our ability to augment that with biologic products certainly is a area of great excitement for the future. And more importantly, perhaps patches and bio washers can be the perfect scaffold and vehicle to deliver those biologics. Well, why is that so important? The reason that's so important is we know something about the healing triad. And our basic science colleagues have taught us that when we have an interface that is challenged with healing, perhaps compromised tissue or revision surgery, what do we need to happen? We need at least two of these three triad elements to be present to have any chance of success. We need to have a scaffold that offers some time zero biomechanical strength. We need to have the growth factors present that can stimulate the inherent healing response in the native tissue. And if that tissue is deficient in responding cells, then we need to augment with the right type of cells to respond. And that's where our armamentarium that we have available through many of the products that now help us as surgeons allow us to address this triad in every patient. We can deliver a scaffold such as a patch. We can augment it with ACP that's replete in growth factors. And we can even consider bone marrow or lipid-based aspirate to identify and isolate stem cells to augment healing. And all of us are familiar with sometimes operations like this that used to be referred to as the peek and shriek operation, where we would put a camera in the joint, see this chronically severely retracted rotator cuff tear medial to the glenoid with compromised greater tuberosity real estate, and sometimes abandon this surgery. Well, I would argue in 2021, with the tools available to us, there are still joint preserving operations available, even short of superior capsular reconstruction. So why consider reinforcing with a biologic matrix? Why consider a biowasher or Arthroflex patch? Well, as I mentioned, it's a failed biology that leads to anatomic failure, but at time zero, it's failed biomechanics. And we can address both with these patches. In our older population and larger tears, as I've mentioned, we tend to focus on anchor pullout. But the reality is our big issue exists with suture pull-through, particularly at the lateral edge of the tendon or in type 2 tear revision scenarios. We want to have material like an Arthroflex patch that supports cellular repopulation, rapidly integrates into the native tissue without a foreign body granulomatous reaction, and supports revascularization. And as you can see from the studies shown below, the Arthroflex patch and biowashers do just that. Over time, they incorporate, they augment biology, and in the short term, augment our time zero mechanics. I want to point out that as many of us focus in different aspects of the body as we become more and more subspecialized, we don't want to lose the value of thinking about principles that apply across the body, right? This has not been a foreign concept when you look at, for example, an extensor mechanism repair shown here, courtesy of my colleague, Rafi Mirzayan. You know, when we have compromised, difficult to sew patellar tendon, augmenting with a patch here is often something we do to improve our time zero strength, to augment compromised tissue quality. These principles can be applied across tendons or ligaments throughout the body, where we have the same challenges of healing of tendon to bone, oftentimes in compromised areas of watershed vascularity. So let's use those principles as we apply it to different parts of our challenges. Here's the principle of the Arthroflex biowasher and why I think it should be in every surgeon's toolbox. These are small pre-shaped pieces of Arthroflex patch that come as 10 by 14 by 2 millimeters in size. Why they are so useful really comes down to our workflow as surgeons. One of the things that's daunting and intimidating to us is often feeling like we need to complete a rotator cuff tear with native tissue, which sometimes in these complex tear patterns is in and of itself challenging. And then we need to add a layer of complexity by thinking about how we will now deliver a patch and fix a patch on top of that repair. Well, these biowashers take that challenge out of the equation, because they truly act like grommets that you can slide down your sutures, or you can incorporate them at the time of passing your suture into the scorpion. And that allows you minimal additional complexity, minimal additional time in the operating room or concern that this is going to complement or complicate your prior repair. It integrates into the repair and can act as a scaffold for biologic delivery. And I would point out for all of us who are not as sophisticated in the world of biomechanics, it's really not that complicated, anything more than we used to augment our notebook paper in our three-hole punches, right? Creating that additional reinforcement with a biologic scaffold at our point of the of weakest link, which is that suture tendon interface, is the purpose of this device. And for us, a biologic device that also has the favorable effect of augmenting biology at the later phases of recovery. So has this been borne out? Well, I've had the fortune of working with John Konasek and Josh Carnes and the team here, where we looked at speed bridge constructs with and without a medial biowasher. We took our worst case scenario, thin attritic rotator cuff tissue in elderly cadaveric specimens. And no surprise, when we simply pulled the construct to load to failure, we saw no difference. But of course, all of us know that that's not the mechanism by which rotator cuff tears fail. They fail with cyclic loading. And so we loaded those constructs cyclically and looked at gap formation. We looked at load to failure in a cyclic construct. And no surprise, augmentation with the biowasher at time zero reduced those modes of failure and offer a lot of optimism for when we should consider them in the right tear in the right patient. Well, fortunately, due to great work again from my colleague Rafi Mirzayan and Alan Hirahara and others, we now have both ultrasound and MRI-based imaging that teaches us that these patches do in fact incorporate. So they're not there like grommets that are there permanently and never become part of our construct. These incorporate and become a scaffold for revascularization and to augment the ultimate strength of your tendon tissue. In fact, in Rafi's series, 0 of 18 had retorn at 3 months. And we know from the literature, including out of our own center from Bruce Miller and others, that rotator cuff tears, when they fail early. So why is this so exciting for me? You know, when I kind of started practice, I felt like I had a void of patients. You know, there were those that I would offer a rotator cuff repair to. And then there would be patients that I'd see in the clinic and say, boy, I want to repair this, but I don't have confidence it will work. Or 2 years later, I would see them back and the construct had failed. And I would say, I wonder if I should have just gone to a total shoulder replacement for them. And now in 2021, it is so exciting to see that in that short period of time, between that first outcome and the last outcome are all of these options, which include the biowashers, an Arthroflex patch to augment not only at the suture tendon interface, but across the entire tendon. The concept of a Kaufman, where we can augment with biology in a minimally invasive way, even considering autograft tissue like the long head of the biceps tendon, superior capsule reconstruction with a partial cuff to maintain the force couple, the bar procedure where we can resurface both on the humeral and the acromial side, and then bioplasty, where we're even considering Arthroflex patches for interposition or to augment rotator cuff repairs in conjunction with arthroplasty. So you can imagine this void that was present just 10 years ago has now been filled with so many options that continue to push the limit on joint preservation. And that's why we see images like this for those patients that I would encounter in 2009 that now in 2021 continue to do well with Arthroflex patch-based superior capsule reconstruction and or bar procedures. This image borrowed from Jay Okish, who's done a wonderful job for an elderly patient with one of these conditions. So what are the potential indications for me for biowashers in 2021? Well, I think any situation where I want a scaffold that has time zero biomechanical strength to improve a compromised repair and what could be a vehicle for biologic delivery makes a ton of sense. And so in this MRI, you can see here the dreaded type 2 tear where part of the footprint remains attached to the greater tuberosity. We know that purchase and that more medial cuff tissue could be compromised or be vulnerable to a type 2 tear. These are situations where we want to think about augmentation. So for me, revision tears, type 2 tears, compromised or thin tissue, or a situation where I want to use the biowasher as a scaffold for biologic delivery, these are all the scenarios in 2021 that I'm employing this technique. So I want to bring it together with sharing a case, a recent case of mine, a 38-year-old, very active female who presented to my clinic as a referral from two other orthopedic surgeons, and you'll see why. She's 38, and she truly presents with a pseudo-paralytic shoulder. She can only raise her arm up 30 degrees. She cannot externally rotate beyond neutral. She does appear to have an intact subscap with a normal bear hug and belly press test, has strong internal rotation, but really can do nothing with her dominant arm. As you get more of the history, you find that unfortunately she's had a prior traumatic postural superior cuff tear that involved her entire supra and infraspinatus from kettlebell lifting at CrossFit. She underwent a rotator cuff repair at the index 2013. That unfortunately failed and was revised by the same surgeon in 2017, but now has gone on to recurrent failure. She comes into the clinic stating that she can't use her dominant arm even for routine activities of daily living. She can't comb her hair or brush her teeth. She can't raise the top, reach the top cabinet. And this is at the age of 38. Now, of course, one of the bigger challenges for us is then when we look at her imaging studies, we see things like this. Here you can see artifact from multiple metal anchors at the greater tuberosity footprint, which leads us to compromised real estate. We see retracted compromised tendon tissue, perhaps even a portion of retained tissue at the greater tuberosity footprint, concerning for a type 2 tear. We even see some mild superior migration of the humeral head, but fortunately on the axial images, an intact subscapularis tendon. In 2009, this would be a patient that I would honestly send for continued rehabilitation, perhaps corticosteroid injection, and sort of tell them to suck it up until I could get to an age where an arthroplasty was an option. But in 2021, I feel like we've been armed with all of the tools that I've shared to take this patient on with a reasonable approach. So we took her to the operating room, and this is what we found. As you can see here, the good fortune of an intact subscapularis tendon on the top left. Here you can see in the middle top image, a greater top tuberosity footprint, where you can see the remnants of the prior multiple cuff repairs. Here you can see on the top right, even one of the metal anchors from the prior cuff repair that's sitting prominent in our footprint where we hope to have healing. But again, most concerning, and the subject for this talk, is we often get fixated on the greater tuberosity and the bone. Look at our tendon tissue here. At the bottom left, we have something that we can reduce to bone, but it's thin. There's multiple cleavage planes. We even see a hole in the tendon tissue. We can see compromise and propagation along the posterior interval at the bottom right. And this is a scenario where we're now thinking about not just revision repair, but can we augment our time zero mechanics and can we improve biology? And this is how we approach that. You can see at the top left my concern here with a switching stick, multiple cleavage planes extending all the way to the glenoid margin there. I actually was able to thread the metal anchor there in the middle image, remove that metal anchor, recreate normal healthy bone at the greater tuberosity footprint, but now take advantage of the Arthroflex patch and bio washers. So here I initially employed a speed bridge type of construct, passing those fiber tape sutures through bio washers in that medial interface, as well as through the native tissue, medial to those cleavage planes. I then brought those back down to a lateral row, but augmented with an additional Arthroflex patch at the lateral footprint to maximize the biomechanical strength at the tendon bone interface, as well as at the suture tendon interface, and to thicken this attritic tissue, but be able to preserve the native muscle tendon unit and not go straight to a superior capsular reconstruction in this very young patient that still has viable healthy muscle bellies on the MRI. And the proof is in the pudding. You know, for me at 14 months out, this is now over a year, she has ASCS and WOSI scores in the 90s. She came to me truly Thursday of this past week with full forward elevation of 175 degrees, recalling she started at 30 degrees, external rotation to 40 degrees, and 5 out of 5 manual strength of her posterior superior cuff. She actually is doing all of her activities of daily living with her dominant arm. And to my dismay, she made inquiry about returning back to CrossFit, which was, of course, the inception of her injury. And to me, that was in some ways the most favorable and gratifying aspect of this was that she was now inquiring about activities that were prior to any injury and prior to any cuff repair that speaks to her level of confidence and function. And this is an outcome I felt I never could have achieved without having access to these patches and this technology. And so with that in mind, I thank you and hope this has been an informative discussion about where we can augment our conventional approaches to cuff repair surgery and marry biology with scaffolds, great time zero constructs for our most challenging patients. Thank you.